Hello children, after completing the concept of interference of waves, we are going to discuss polarization, which is another important topic and proves that light is actually a wave, right? Before we can understand polarization, we'll just explore the types of waves once again. If you remember, types of waves we discussed in class 11, there are two types of waves. One is transverse and the other one is longitudinal waves. Now we'll just refresh transverse waves and longitudinal waves. We'll just refresh our knowledge of these two waves on the basis of, you know, wave is produced by oscillation of particles of the medium, right? Now, transverse waves are produced when particles of the medium oscillate in a direction perpendicular to the propagation of the wave, meaning this wave is going to travel like this in the form of crests and troughs. These are crests and these are troughs. So, we need to keep in mind, this is how the transverse wave is being propagated. On the other hand, a longitudinal wave, if you remember, travels in the form of something like this. This is compression, this is compression, and then this is rarefaction, right? This is rarefaction, compression, and this is rarefaction. This is how the wave is traveling. The difference being, in case of longitudinal wave, the particles of the medium are oscillating perpendicular to direction of propagation of the wave. Let us say that the wave is propagating along x axis, then the wave is the particles are oscillating perpendicular to x axis. Let us say they are oscillating perpendicular to y-axis, meaning the particles are oscillating perpendicular direction of propagation of the wave, whereas in case of longitudinal waves, like in case of a spring, you have seen the spring moves like this, and this is the direction in which it is, the wave is traveling. So, in case of longitudinal wave, the particles of the medium are oscillating in the direction of propagation of the wave. Now, coming back to light, we know that light is constituted of these kind of oscillations. In fact, every time the photon moves, a charged particle is accelerated, then produces a photon, and there are two components in it. As you have already done, there is electric field component and there is what? Magnetic field component. Let us see once again here. This is x axis, this is y axis, and this is z axis. The two components are, one is electric field. This is electric field, and then we have magnetic field. The magnetic field is directed like this. We did it. Right? This is E and this is B. And you already know that out of the two components, and the wave is traveling along which axis? X axis. The wave is traveling along x axis, electric field is along y axis, and the magnetic field is along z axis. Now, when we discuss polarization, in fact, we will see that polarization is seen only in case of transverse waves and not in case of longitudinal waves. Why so? We will be discussing that also. So, keep in mind two things. Number one, polarization is produced only in case of transverse waves, and therefore, this experiment will conclusively show that light is composed of what waves? Transverse waves. And then after these two components in the electromagnetic wave spectrum, and the electromagnetic wave, as light is electromagnetic wave, this is what you are saying, we will not be considering B, because magnetic field does not produce any optical sensation. So, the light vector is which vector? Electric field vector. So, when I will be discussing polarization, I will be only exploring electric field and not the magnetic field. Okay? So, let us say this. So, children, let us see one simple experiment here. This is ordinary light, for example. This is ordinary light coming out of a source. And then when I'm saying it's ordinary light, means it's containing vibrations in all possible directions. Clear? Now there are certain materials. For example, if you take a tourmaline crystal, for example, here I have a tourmaline crystal. This tourmaline crystal has a special property. When this ordinary light is allowed to pass through this tourmaline crystal, then we see that this light here, if I suppose I have bulb here, switch on the bulb, then light will be scattered in all possible directions, means electric field will be dancing along all possible directions that you can imagine, right? So this is how the electric field vectors are directed. Okay? Now when this ordinary light, which is scattered in all possible directions, when it is allowed to pass through the tourmaline crystal, we find that this light is no longer scattered like this. In fact, after passing through this tourmaline crystal, it is confined to a single direction. It's confined to a single direction. Now, this phenomenon is what you call is polarization. Meaning, when ordinary light is allowed to pass through certain substances, it is confined to a single direction, right? And this direction is only perpendicular to the plane of propagation of light. Remember, out here also light is traveling like this, and even after passing also it is traveling like this. There is no change in direction of the velocity of light. And this crystal is a very special crystal, tourmaline crystal. We can also use a calcite prism. So the phenomenon of confining ordinary light to a single direction after it passes through certain substances is called what? Polarization. And this light now has been confined to a single direction. So we'll call it plane polarized light. Plane polarized light. We also call it linearly polarized light. Let's understand it once again. When ordinary light is allowed to pass through certain substances, it is confined to a certain direction, to a single direction, and this direction is perpendicular to direction of propagation of light. And this phenomenon is called polarization. So let's define what is polarization of light. So here is what I have written, children. When ordinary light is allowed to pass through certain substances, it is confined to a single direction. This phenomenon is called what? Polarization of light. Now why it is happening like this? Why this light is confined to a single direction? Let's try to understand what is the reason for this. Suppose the light is propagating along x axis, and the plane of the crystal is placed along which axis? Y axis. You can imagine like this. This is how the tourmaline crystal is placed, and this is how the light is traveling. Clear? And the light out here is scattered in all possible directions. Ordinary light will have its component along all possible directions. Let's see this. In fact, children, this ordinary light, it has got electric field vectors scattered in all possible directions. Now, I can resolve these components along two directions. Suppose one component is along x axis, right, ex, and the other component is along y, that is what, ey. Clear? Now what we see, children, when these two components are summarily, these electric field components, which are directed along all possible directions, we can resolve them into two directions. One is along x axis, the other is along which axis? Y axis. Clear? Now, the components when they are allowed to hit this tourmaline crystal, tourmaline crystal is like this, and it is different from other crystals in what way? It has its molecules arranged along certain directions forming an axis. So one group of molecules will be directed like this, the other group of molecules will be directed like this, and it will generate its own planes like this. Like this. Clear? Like my fingers, there is spacing here. So this will act like windows, like this. So when the light will hit like this, there are two components. The two components, one is EY, which is going like this, and the other is EX, which is going like this. So you can clearly see that EY will be permitted to go through, this component will be permitted to go through, and this component EX will be blocked. This component EX will be blocked. That means only those components will be allowed to pass which are parallel to these windows of the tourmaline crystal. You can see this clearly here. This is acting like, so once again, I have two components. One component is parallel to these windows. So when this component EY will hit here, it will go right through. But EX will be hitting like this, it will be blocked. So you can see that out of these two components, only one component is being allowed to pass. And this is the component that we are having. This component is perpendicular to direction of propagation of this wave. Clear? So obviously, only one component is going through. Now, this can also be represented like this. We can assume that ordinary light, in fact, is like this. These are parallel, these are along y axis, and these are the other component, which is EX. So we can also demonstrate like this. This is ordinary light we are depicting here. In this light, these components I'm denoting by EY. And these components which are oscillating like this, they've been denoted as EX. So you can understand once again. Suppose this is EY, so it will go through. And the components which are directed perpendicular to the plane, they'll be like this. So they'll be blocked. So out of these two components, ordinary light you can represent like this, and we can represent like this also. When this ordinary light is being allowed to pass here through tourmaline crystal, then these dots are being prevented, and only the straight lines which are representing oscillations in the plane of the board. You can see that these oscillations lying in the plane like this, plane of the board. These dots are oscillating like this, so these are blocked. So only half of the electric field vectors are being allowed to pass. So there are two important consequences. One is, first component consequences, the light has been confined to a single direction, number one. And number two, that only half of the light is being allowed to pass, the intensity of the output light will be nearly half the intensity of the input light. The output intensity, you know what is intensity? Intensity, the amount of energy passing through unit surface area at right angle in unit time, right? We've already done it. In interference, we discussed. So the output intensity will be reduced. Yes, only half of the electric field signals are being allowed to pass. Clear? So what we understood? We understood that when light will be allowed to pass through certain substances, like calcite crystal, for example, then we have a tourmaline crystal, then it will be confined to a single direction. This phenomenon is what we call is polarization of light. And it's very obvious from this discussion that in case of longitudinal wave, the oscillations will be like this. So these oscillations, let's understand it here. These are openings and oscillations are going like this. Not like this, they're going like this. So oscillations will be easily passing through, there'll be no effect. Right? Even if you put like this, then also they'll pass. and you put like this, then also they will pass. So therefore, longitudinal waves cannot be polarized. Only which waves can be polarized? Only transverse waves can be polarized. Clear? Once we understood this, then let us see what is a polarizer and what is an analyzer. But keep in mind that polarization will consist of only half the intensity of the incident light. Clear? And only those signals will be allowed to pass which are parallel to the windows or parallel to the plane of the crystal. Clear? Okay. So, children, in this experiment I have placed two crystals parallel to each other. For example, one crystal is like this, another crystal is like this, okay? And both the planes are parallel. Imagine, this ordinary light, now this ordinary light, the electric field vectors you have considered in two directions. One is along y axis, the other is along z axis, and the wave is propagating along which axis? X axis. Clear? Now this is the first crystal, and as we have said already, that oscillations of light which are lying in the plane are parallel to the what? Plane of the crystal, are parallel to the windows of, if you go to the microscopic level, then they are parallel to the planes of the windows of the turbulent crystal. So, the oscillation which along y axis they are being transmitted. Clear? Now, what I will do is, I will put another crystal and I will keep this crystal parallel to the first crystal. I am going to check whether light has been polarized or not. Now, when the plane of the other crystal is parallel to the first crystal, then we observe it from the other side and then we see that light is indeed passing onto the other side. For example, in this ordinary light, you have considered 5 oscillations which are lying in the plane of the board, 5 oscillations are perpendicular. When the light is passing through the first crystal, then you can see that which are oscillating perpendicular to the board, they have been cut off, they have been removed, they have been blocked, and only 5 are being allowed to pass. And on the other side also, only 5 are being allowed to pass. Now, what I am going to do is, the other crystal, children, is like this, is parallel to the first crystal. Now, I found that all the signals, whatever signals were here, same signals are passing on to the other side, I can see it. What I am doing now is, I am going to turn the second crystal like this. As I turn the other crystal like this, then you can see that this amplitude will be cut off, yes, because there will be only small component only perpendicular to the windows now, the windows are drawn like this, okay, or like this I can put. Now we find that as I start rotating the second crystal, then the amount of light going on to the other side is also what? Beginning to decrease. And we will reach a situation where the two crystals were initially parallel. Now one crystal is perpendicular to the other crystal. When one crystal will become perpendicular to the other crystal, then you can see now these are the windows. So, if I put it like this, perpendicular, then these components of electric field which are passing through the first crystal, they will become perpendicular to the plane of the second crystal. If the second crystal put it like this, and then what will you see on the other side? You will be seeing that all the signals have been blocked on this side, there will be no signals. So, if I arrange like this, this is the first crystal which we have here, and then this is the other crystal. These two crystals are placed now perpendicular to each other. Here we have 5 units of electric field vectors, let us say the polarized light passing through the first crystal, and now when I see from the other side, I find at this side there is darkness, no signals are going on to the other side. Means whether the light after passing through the first crystal has been polarized or not, we can test this by rotating the other crystal. And what we found? If the second crystal is parallel to the first crystal, then all the light is passing through. However, when I start turning, then intensity of the other side goes on decreasing. And when the other crystal is perpendicular to the first crystal, then there is absolutely no signal, they have been blocked because they are perpendicular to the axis of the second crystal. So the second crystal can be used to actually analyze whether the light has been polarized after passing through the first crystal, and therefore this is called analyzer, and the first crystal is called what? Polarizer. So there are two crystals we are using here. The first crystal is called polarizer and the second crystal is analyzer. Clear? So by using the analyzer we can actually check whether the light has been polarized or not. For example, if this crystal, the same crystal becomes something like this, the second crystal becomes something like this, then the amount of light passing through the second crystal will decrease. Okay? So you have to know this nomenclature. The first crystal is called polarizer, the second crystal is called analyzer. Clear? Now, there was a physicist named Malus. He studied the variation of intensity as the other crystal is rotated. Clear? And therefore, we will be discussing what is Malus law. So keep in mind, before I teach you Malus law, I want you to understand this. What are the consequences of polarization? What are the consequences of polarization? Let's understand. Okay? Now, children, so the three consequences that we have of polarization. First one is light is confined to single direction, intensity of light is reduced, and glare is also reduced. So I was talking about how the intensity changing. Remember, intensity of light or any wave is directly proportional to amplitude. So when I'm saying intensity is being reduced, so it is all about reducing the amplitude. Okay, let's see one typical case. Like this is ordinary light, or this is suppose light after polarization. This is our polarizer. Okay, one pulse went like this, ordinary pulse. After passing through, it got confined to a single direction. This component got blocked, and this component is allowed to pass. Then what I'm doing is, I'm tilting the analyzer like this. This arm tilting the analyzer. Okay. This arm tilting the analyzer. The analyzer has become something like this. Then obviously, the signal which is passing on the other side will be reduced. It will become something like this. It will become smaller. Now, as this amplitude becomes smaller, then obviously this intensity will be also reduced. So we are going to discuss what you call is Malus law. We'll see how this intensity is actually changing. Now this is the amplitude. Suppose this amplitude is A, or you can say this is A naught. Now when I bend the crystal by an angle theta, then this length A naught will become something like this. By what angle I am bending it? Theta. So you can see that this amplitude A naught has been reduced now. It has become something like this, right? So when I am bending, that this amplitude becomes like this. This is A naught, so this is also what? A naught. And this is the new amplitude, A. I'll say this is O, this is A, and this is B, and this is C. Clear? So you can see here that OC is going to be equal to how much? OA is equal to A naught. And when I'm rotating the analyzer, then the angle becomes how much? Theta. So what is the new amplitude? The new amplitude becomes A, and A from the diagram is equal to how much? OB. Right diagram is equal to how much? OB. This distance becomes A. Let me erase this I. The distance becomes A. So if you want to calculate A, it is very easy. This angle is how much? 90 degree. I can easily calculate OB by OA. OA is equal to how much? Cos theta. So A by A naught is going to be equal to how much? Cos theta. So how much is A? A naught cos theta. So if angle between analyzer and polarizer is theta, then how much amplitude? A equals to A cos theta. If I square, then on squaring what do I get? Square, then A square will be A naught square cos square theta. Clear? And then A square is how much here? New intensity. And A naught is what? The intensity after polarization. Then I dash becomes I naught cos square theta. And this law is called popularly Malus law. That if angle between analyzer and polarizer is theta, then intensity I dash will be I naught cos square theta. I naught being constant, we can also say I dash is directly proportional to cos square theta. You can just call it I also, not I dash. Clear? Where I naught is intensity of polarized light. Clear? So it's a beautiful law that intensity of polarized light is directly proportional to square of cosine of the angle between the polarizer and the analyzer, and this is called what? Malus law. Okay. Malus law. Clear? We have two crystals. This is analyzer and this is polarizer. Clear? And this angle, children, out here is theta. This is what we are saying. This is the light here out of polarization through the first crystal, and we are saying that this side, this amplitude will be reduced, and we derived it very easily here. This is A naught. This angle is what? Theta. Clear? So we can calculate it by using vector resolution also. This is again at 90 degree. This angle is how much? 90 degree. You can see from this diagram as well. Component of A naught in direction theta, in fact here you can very easily understand this is A cos, A naught cos theta, that is equal to A. Clear? So when we have angle theta between polarizer and analyzer, so A equals A naught cos theta, and we said intensity of light after passing through analyzer. Intensity of light after passing through analyzer is directly proportional to square of cosine of the angle between polarizer and analyzer. So this law is called what? Malus law. I is directly equal to cos square theta. I equals to I naught cos square theta, where I naught is intensity of the polarized light. Clear? Intensity of light after passing through analyzer is directly equal to cos square theta, and cos square theta maximum value can be 1, and 1 is possible only when these are parallel. If one is like this, one crystal is like this, and the other crystal is like this, the parallel, then cos square theta is 1, and in this case I will be equal to I naught. Clear? However, for the minimum value, you know, minimum value of cos square theta is 0. If one crystal is like this and the other crystal is like this, they are perpendicular to each other, then how much will be I out here? 0. Clear? So this is what you have to know. No signals will be passing through. For example, let's see here. If theta equals to, suppose 60 degree, angle between analyzer and polarizer is 60 degree, then from here, intensity of polarized light after passing through analyzer will be I naught cos square 60. I naught cos 60 is how much? Half square. So I will be how much here? I naught by 4. Meaning, if angle between analyzer and polarizer, suppose this is how they are, this angle is being what? 60 degree. Angle between analyzer, this analyzer, and suppose this is polarizer. Angle between them is plane, their planes is how much? 60 degree. Then only 1/4 of the intensity will be propagated. Means only 25% light will be allowed to pass, the rest already blocked. Clear? We get simple numericals on this. We can reverse it and you can see a problem. What is the angle between analyzer and polarizer? If only 25% of light is allowed to pass through the analyzer, then obviously theta will be how much? 60 degree. Clear? So you can get sums like this and you have to be able to solve. Now children, we understood what is Malus law. Just keep in mind, very important, that intensity of light is reduced after polarization, and if angle between analyzer and polarizer 90 degree, no light is allowed to pass. Clear? Now what are the methods of polarization? There are many methods of polarization that we will be discussing. Methods of polarization, in how many ways we can actually polarize? There are many ways. Like we have polarization. So we have polarization by reflection, we are doing this just now, then polarization by scattering, and also polarization by what? Refraction. So there are many ways in which we can achieve polarization. We can also use polarization by using dichroic materials or doubly refracting materials. Clear? Now we are doing first polarization by reflection. Okay, let's say this. Polarization by reflection. Let's understand what is polarization by reflection. You understand what is reflection already? Here we have a reflecting surface. This is a reflecting surface. Okay. Imagine a situation in which ordinary light is incident on this surface. This is ordinary light which is incident on this surface. This ordinary light, children, is like this, which is incident. Now this ordinary light, in fact, like we said earlier, can be resolved in two directions, right, two perpendicular directions. So this ordinary light becomes something like this. This ordinary light. Clear. Now these components are in the plane of the board. Okay. And these dots are oscillating like this. Clear. Imagine in which I use a surface like this. There are two components. One component is driven like this. You can clearly understand if one component will be driven like this, then what will happen to this component? It will easily pass through the surface, it will go on to the other side. But the components which are perpendicular to this will be oscillating like this, and these components will not be going into the reflecting surface, they will not be transmitted on the other side. So in this case, these signals which are lying in the plane, once they'll hit the reflecting surface, then they'll be absorbed by the surface or they'll be transmitted. However, these oscillations which are like this, they will not be absorbed by the surface. Signals like this, they'll be absorbed, and signals like this will not be absorbed. So what will happen to this signal, children? These dots will be thrown back like this. And then I'll consider this as the normal. There is no surface which is perfectly reflecting. So these signals which you are seeing, which are lying in the plane, and some of these signals as well, these will pass through onto the other side. It may have some of these signals also, which are oscillating perpendicular, but most of the signals will be in the plane of this board. Clear? So what we see as a consequence of this, that as we go on varying the angle out here, the angle of incidence, then there is a certain angle at which, there is a certain angle of incident at which the reflected ray is completely plane polarized, and some signals inevitably will pass through the other side, and they will be constituting what ray? Refracted ray. And these signals will be constituting what ray? Reflected ray. Let's go back to this once again. When ordinary light is incident on a reflecting surface, this is what surface? This is a reflecting surface. Then some of these signals are reflected and some are transmitted. Now, for a certain angle of incidence here, the reflected signals or the reflected light is completely plane polarized. Now, this is very important if you understand this. For a certain angle of incidence, this polarization and transmission will take place all the time. But for a certain angle of incidence, the reflected ray or the reflected light is completely plane polarized. And this angle is a very special angle. It depends upon the nature of the surfaces in contact. And this angle is called angle of polarization. Okay, so once again, when ordinary light is incident on a reflecting surface, then for a certain angle of incidence, the reflected light is completely plane polarized. Clear? Now, this angle is called angle of polarization. Clear? And at this stage, the angle between the reflected ray and the transmitted ray is 90 degree, meaning these two rays are perpendicular to each other. It is clear? So let's write this. Okay, this angle is called angle of polarization, right? It was ordered by Malus, and then mathematically it was framed into an equation by Brewster. So we also call it Brewster's law. Okay. IP. So children, When an ordinary light is incident on a reflecting surface, then for a certain angle of incidence, the reflected ray is completely plane polarized, and this angle is called angle of incidence. So, what are conditions for polarization by reflection? One is that angle of incidence should be equal to angle of polarization, that is IP. Number one, and the reflected and refracted ray should be at 90 degree to each other. So, what are the conditions we'll be writing? Conditions for should be perpendicular. So, there are two conditions, children. Angle of incidence should be equal to angle of polarization, that is IP, and the reflected and refracted ray should be perpendicular to each other. Now, using this condition, Brewster was able to frame a law that is called Brewster's law. We'll see what is Brewster's law. We can very easily understand, children. Angle of incidence is equal to angle of reflection. So, if this is IP, then this angle will also be IP. Clear? This angle is already given as 90 degree. And this angle is angle of reflection. So, if this is already 90 degree, then IP plus R will be how much up? 90. Because this total angle is how much up? 180 degree. So, I will say, let angle of refraction is equal to R. Okay. So, IP plus 90 plus R will be equal to how much? 180. So, IP plus 90 degree plus R will be equal to 180 degree. If you solve it, then R becomes how much? 90 minus IP. This is a very important relation. R is equal to 90 minus IP. Clear? Now, if I use Snell's law, therefore, mu is how much, children? Sin I by sin R. And children, we know that I is equal to how much? IP. So, I can write sin IP divided by sin 90 minus IP. And sin 90 minus theta is equal to how much? Cos theta. So, we get the equation out here. Mu is equal to sin IP divided by cos IP. And sin by cos is how much? Tan. So, here we get mu is equal to tan IP. Now, this is an important equation, and this equation is popularly known as Brewster's law. The law says the refractive index is equal to the tangent of angle of polarization. Okay. Let's see this. Let's write down this law. So, children, according to Brewster's law, the refractive index of a medium is equal to the tangent of angle of polarization. We derived just now, mu is equal to tan IP, right? For example, suppose if I take, if IP is equal to 60 degree, then how much will be mu? Tan 60 degree, and tan 60 degree is what? Root 3, which is 1.732. Clear? So, we went through the basics of polarization in the video. In the next video, we will be discussing polaroids, some numerical applications, and many more things. Okay? Thank you.